He's back again one more time for Holy Hijinks. I'm in the car. Welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. I am back adventuring, going to Halloween Hijinks tonight, WrestleZone's big event at Curl Aberdeen that I'm going to have to go find, because I've no idea where that is. This is excellent visual content for you right now. There we go. Right. Yeah, so Curl Aberdeen, I don't know where that is. I did a little check on Google Maps and it seems to be near Wood End Hospital, so I got a rough idea where that is, but failing that, I do have a mobile phone, so it'll direct me there when I get to it. But I am looking forward to this show tonight. I am so buzzing, I'm so scared at the same time. And if anyone has saw my preview that I wrote on SWN.com, I did a preview of the show, and all the matches, they're going to be really, really good, really good. But that main event's the scary one. It's Zach Dynamite defending the undisputed WrestleZone Championship against Aspen Faith, and this is being teased. This is a Halloween brawl. So usually Halloween brawls are like big jokey affairs. Like last year we had Mickey Vago had a pumpkin on his head to use as a battering ram, and there was like sweets used as like quote unquote thumbtacks. So it's usually like reserved as a bit of a fun thing, caper for Halloween. But from what we're gathering, this is a more of a personal rivalry, a personal feud, and that means that this is going to be quite a bit more of a hardcore affair. Aspen's really experienced in like death matches and stuff like that, so he's more used to that kind of pain and torture. But Zach Dynamite is still an incredible wrestler and is able to adapt to just about anything. So it's going to be a very chaotic match. I'm going to have a lot of feelings, a lot of emotions out of it. So we'll see if I do a montage, how I'm doing after that. Because it could just be, I might still have the sunglasses on, even though it'll be pitch black, because I'll just be all like emotional and crying. Elsewhere on the show, got Grado coming back. Grado's coming to WrestleZone for the first time since Aberdeen Anarchy 2019. So I'm buzzing to see Grado. This could be the only chance I'll get Grado on the podcast, since he doesn't answer his own emails. So who knows? This could be the chance if I'm able to get a little bit of video footage saying it's yourself and all that jazz. He's against Ronan King, and he did send in a question for the show for this little portion, because he was talking about pretty much asking in the preview I did of this match. I said if Ronan King wins, then my TikTok For You page is going to be overrun with Ronan King videos. He's pretty much asking how it's going to feel when he sees all the videos on TikTok, or how TikTok's going to cope with all the videos. And I don't know. I mean, I see a lot of stuff on TikTok, mostly it's wrestling stuff, because, you know, big wrestling dork here. And, you know, I'm not against seeing some more Ronan King. Kelly has calmed down Ronan, so she's fine. She's her mama bear, or her king of the pride kind of thing, is queen of the pride, is kind of chilled out now, so she's not off after your head anymore. Although if you do get barred by Grado, she's probably still won't be upset by it. So there's that. But it's a really exciting opportunity for Ronan. Grado had a lot of complimentary things to say about just from his sheer physique and his look and his antics on social media. And if there's a guy that you can impress who's pretty much done everything in Scottish wrestling and beyond, Grado is a pretty good cat to get the thumbs up from. So it's going to be a really fun match. We've got the Tri-County Championship match, which is going to be a hell of a lot of fun. Caleb Valhalla against Captain Al Sterling, with Mickey Vago defending the Tri-County Championship. That's going to be a hell of a lot of pure entertainment. We've seen Alan and Caleb, we've seen Alan and Vago. We saw Vago and Caleb mix up in last year's Halloween Hijinks. So to see them actually all kind of collide now, it's going to be it's going to be absolute chaos in that match. Elsewhere, we've got the tag team titles. We've got Mr. P and Sean Johnson in a Halloween switcheroo match against the champions, Foundation of Future, Bruiser Brad Evans and Ryan Riley. So I can't I'm really interested to see just how that works out, because I haven't seen the past Switch Room match. I saw the pictures of it. Mr. P was involved again. I think it's because it's pretty easy to do a Mr. P cosplay. It's kilt, bald cap, a bit of makeup, a bit of like saltire makeup, and you know, jobber goon. So I'm just really interested to see who's ended up being Mr. P, and just seeing how this all plays out. Scotty Smith versus Brian Tucker is also on the show. That's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be because I've never seen these guys face off, because at this point, I mean, up until like 2019, mid-2019, Brian Tucker had always been the perennial underdog babyface guy, right? So he's never, and so Scotty Swift. So you've never seen these guys kind of mix up in an actual proper one-on-one match, I don't think, from my research and notes. From my memory, the only time they've ever actually clashed in a match that's outside of a rumble, would have been a fatal four-way. Can't remember when though. Maybe it was 2019. But they haven't really mixed up anything. They haven't really had matches together, other than teaming up with each other and what have you. So it's going to be quite interesting. Every match on this is interesting. And I'm not going to forget one or two, and I apologise in advance for when I do. We've got the pre-show match, we've got the VIP bonus ticket holder match, which is the triple threat. It's theatre versus film versus music. When we've got Rhys Dawkins, Omar Muhammad, and Chris Archer. I had to forget your name, I'll just read them. Chris Archer, so it's triple threat. There's a lot of triple threat matches on tonight for Halloween Hijinks, so plenty of hijinks that can happen, because for those that are unaware of rules of triple threat matches, it's pretty much pinfall or submission. There's no DQ. Things like Halloween Brawls, it's more like they're more speciality matches, because only Halloween objects and that are deemed legal objects. So triple threat matches themselves, there's still no DQ, so that makes it all the more interesting. We've got the gun outfit. Who's outfit facing again? Outfit are against Damien and Conor Malloy. That's it. Damien and Conor Malloy. This is another one that's stemmed from Inverurie. So Damien and Conor were teaming with Caleb Valhalla, take on the Foundation of the Future. And because of some miscommunication, Damien was starting to get a bit rattled and starting to take out a lot of frustration on Dynamite. May have caused a disqualification. Conor stepped in, did a bit of a disagreement. Foundation won. So there's a little bit of uncertainty about the team of Damien and Conor, and they're going against the Outfit, who are a well-oiled machine. Two big lads do two big lad things. So again, that's going to be, I think there's some every match has the potential to have shenanigans. That's what it is. So there's potential for something to happen in every match, some twist and turn, some story, something might not happen, but there's always the open-ended opportunity for it to happen. I think that's every match off the top of my head. I apologise in advance if I have missed. I'll probably check the match card, if I do a second part before I go to wherever I stop, because I'll end up doing a stop, find the venue, do a little bit there, and then go get something to eat, because that's just what happens when I drive to these shows. So I think that's all the matches. So we're going to have a lot of fun in matches like the Triple Threat for the Tri-Counties. We're going to have a lot of fun with the Halloween Switcheroo, and then we're going to have some interesting, scary moments in the main event, Aspen versus Zach Dynamite. That I am just, I don't know how I'm going to feel or what I'm going to think about that whole match. It's terrifying at the thought. There's also a Halloween contest, apparently. I am coming in costume. I am going to be in a costume-ish. I kind of threw it together last night, I'll be perfectly honest with you. It's I don't know if I'll put a picture of it up or what have you. Or maybe I'll put it, I've got a couple of bits I want to try and find while I'm in Aberdeen today. Just to finish off the costume and just see what it looks like. But I've come in as a belt wanker as well. I've taken a European belt, just because, you know, why not? You don't get a chance to take these belts to shows unless you without looking like a total tube. So to take a Halloween show, you know, you may as well make the most of it. So yeah, I do have a costume together. I've kind of half got it on already. Just got some other bits and accents to throw on. So yeah, fingers crossed I'll be able to find them while I'm in town. If not, they'll still look fine. They just make it look better. That's it. And like I said, this is thrown together at the last minute. I didn't even think about coming in costume, and then Kaylee of the K&K podcast, the Wrestle Factory, she contacted me and just went, are you going in costume? And I'm probably not. And I was like, can you? Very much like, okay, I think I can throw together something. I'm coming in costume. I don't know how it's going to go. But you know how my anxiety goes with stuff like this. It's going to be a very, very intriguing moment. This will be the moment I do get a word with Grado or something like that, and we look like an absolute knob. That's just that. That just seems like that. That is the way that things work out. What else can we do in this little first moment, first part? This is not the first podcast since I've done the ITV Celebrity Wrestling Rise and Fall, but that was a hell of a lot of fun, and it's still getting quite a few views now. So thank you for watching that show, watching that video, half an hour of me talking about the rise and fall of ITV Celebrity Wrestling. It was a lot of fun to make, a lot of fun to do, and to put together, find these quotes and what have you. And the weirdest thing is I put in the thing that I did contact all the wrestlers involved, all the competitors, the wrestlers involved, and some of them got back to me. Lee Sharp got back to me. Jenny Powell's PR team got back to me and said no. Victoria Silverstead got back to me, but it hasn't really come to anything. And then after I put out the episode, Scott Wright got back to me. I think he was out of Snake Eyes, possibly. I think that was his name in Celebrity Wrestling. So maybe I'll have a follow-up where we have a little bit of a chat with Scott. I don't know. It's one of those things that just may happen, may not. I have no idea. It's the fun thing about doing this. So I've got more podcasts coming up. I've got two booked in. One I can tell you about. So I've got Colton Davis. That's our Sharp Dojo series. I've got Colton Davis coming back on. So it's the first time I've had a chat with him in a can't remember when I spoke to him, maybe last year, maybe start of last year, I spoke to Colton Davis, maybe actually further back than that, because it was in the small bedroom, and my camera's going wild, sorry. It was in the small bedroom, which is now Jack's room, and I think halfway through, my mother-in-law turned up and shouted for me, because she'd come with soup or something like that. So hopefully we'll do a chat. We'll speak about his adventures in Scandinavia and what else he's doing, because now he's had a few more matches under his belt and we have a little bit more to speak about. And this has been set up through Luke King Sharp's LKS Dojo of Excellence. So thank you to Lou for putting Colton forward and doing all that. He put out some DVDs for the LKS Dojo with some of the guests he's had in the past, Luke King Sharp did. I don't know if anyone's got the DVDs. If you let me know, because he did ask me to send over the interviews that we did for the Sharp Dojo series, when there was a possibility that some of them might go on the DVDs. So if anyone's got the DVDs, let me know, because I wouldn't mind just knowing, seeing the menu screen maybe seeing the menu options, because I sent them over, because you know that's a cool thing, and I'm more than happy to put our episodes forward for it. Because they're a lot of fun to do and a lot of fun to record. And since then, I've caught up with some of them since that episode. Like Stone Malone and Brent Carter and Tom Atlas as well. So we've got to meet them at that stage, and then I've got to speak to them again later on. So it's really cool. That whole Sharp Dojo series is a lot of fun. So bringing that back for season 4.5, and hopefully it'll go into the actual mainstream, back into season 2 come next year. But at the moment, I've got Colt Davis, and then the week after, I'm speaking to Ravishing. He's not Ravishing anymore. He's Retro Randy Valentine, and I can't wait to speak to Randy, because he was the guy. He was the guy that got me into Scottish wrestling. The show I went to in Perth, I drove down to the Dure Centre to go see the show, because I had had Piper, Roddy Piper, it had Teddy DiBiase, it had Tatanka, and it had Chavo Guerrero. So these were the names that were pulling me to the show. So there's a load of story and faff actually getting down there, which I think is on the my chat with Kyle and Kaylee on the KK Wrestle Factory. But anyway, the show happened, and the main event was steel cage match, and in the end, Randy Valentine jumped off the top of the cage with an elbow drop onto, I can't remember who, I don't know if they're on register or not, I can't remember who. Anyway, so yeah, Randy Valentine was the last everlasting moment I had from that show, and that's with all these big name guests as well. So I was hoping to speak to him this year anyway for the podcast, because it's been 10 years since I've been to, since I got into Scottish wrestling. That was August 2012. So now I get to speak to him for a little bit next week. I can't remember when. It's at some point. It's soon. It's booked in anyway. So that leaves 6 slots afterwards. I've got, I think I've got 3 definites. I just need to actually kind of book them into places. And then after that, I've got some past guest DMs and emails and that to reply to and slot them all in. And I got leaves season 4.5 on like 13 episodes or 15, because I might do a couple more specials, because depending if I get to Christmas Chaos, which I might not, but I'm probably going to W3L on December 2nd in Bishop Mill. So that'll be me and brother going to that. So I might do a little bit of stuff then as well. So yeah, there's a lot going on on SWN. Keep it busy, because I'm trying to find ways to do things where I'm doing it by myself, so I'm not having to arrange things or take too much time away from being a dad to do these things. So I've tried a little bit of hand into commentary. I want to keep trying to do that. I'll try to do more like projects like Rise and Fall of ITV Celebrity Wrestling. So there's a lot of things I have in my head that I want to do. It's just knuckling down and actually doing it. I'm still trying to figure out how I'm going to do the SWN 100, because I've started like compiling information and detail and all that kind of stuff before I figure out how I'm going to do it. I know PWI have like a big team that they put forward their lists and what have you, and you know, that maybe that'll be a next year thing. So I'm definitely trying to do SWN 100 this year, basing it from the 1st of December 2021 to the 1st of December 2022. That gives me the month to kind of figure out how I'm calculating it, and then hopefully put out the results on Christmas Day. That would be the hope. That's the plan. We'll see. And then I'll probably do a write-up for like the top 10, maybe. So these things are in my head. It's just trying to formulate them and do them, because I'm still fighting sleep as well. But I mean, it's one of those things, because Jack's doing fantastically. He's throwing in a couple 5-hour sleeps, 6-hour sleeps. He's taking a lot of fluid. He's great. He's absolutely fantastic. He's phenomenal. He's the best thing in my world, in my life. So yeah, it's just, I'm still kind of working out routines and time and things like that, because it's a whole new world. It's the most responsibility I've ever had in my life, and I've got that. That was a bit oddly deep. Let's move on. So yeah, Halloween Hijinks. This is a Holy Hijinks episode, because I like having an alliteration in my episode titles, and I can't wait for it. If you haven't checked out our past episodes, I did Inverurie Invasion, where we went to Inverurie for WrestleZone, and also did Trinity Thriller when we went to Trinity Centre. That episode went a lot longer than I thought it was going to, because it only had, once I did the opening portion in the car, which was only 5 minutes long, and I did the montage, which was like 4 minutes. I thought, that's fine, 15 minute episode, no bother. And then it ended up being a 30 minute episode, because I rambled so much, and like I'm doing now in the aftermath, the day after. So that was an interesting episode. I really enjoyed it, and thanks to the guys that were able to get back to me, and I was able to see some of the matches I missed as well, which is even better. I'm still wanting to see Zach Dynamite and Omar Mohammed play back again. All in for that. I mean, of course, I'm going to hope it's not for the title, just at this moment in time, because I want Aspen to win. But like I said, I'm terrified of the prospect of that match itself. So yeah, that's it. This is the intro. God, it's been 20 minutes. This is the intro to Holy Hijinks, and I cannot wait for WrestleZone Halloween Hijinks tonight at Carl Aberdeen. I will find my way there. I will hopefully be the next part, which will be just outside, just like videotaping. God, videoing. Is that the word? Videoing outside the venue and just going, this is it. I'm now going to go get food. And then I'm going to go probably to Smith's and look at toys, because that's what I do when I'm anxious. I go look at toys, which makes me good. Which means I'm going to be a fantastic dad. So I'm going to get past all this windy roads, and then I'm going to hit stop. And the next thing you probably see is, let's say I'll be in Aberdeen, and just up for some shenanigans, hopefully. So yeah, this is me before the hijinks of Halloween from WrestleZone. I am afraid about how I'm going to look and feel after the show ends. So that's me just about Keith now, you know. I'll get to Keith, that's how we roll, 20 minutes. And then I'll be on my way to Aberdeen. So I hope you enjoy the show. I mean, you would have been in the show if you're watching this already, but I hope you enjoy it as much as I'm probably going to, and I'm going to be quite emotional. So have a good one. Bye. Here we are outside Curl. Crowd's starting already. Quite a queue. Right, I better go get my costume on.
Throne back. I'm sick of being cautious. I'ma go cause some pain, can't stop this. I'ma steal everybody's lane, call it shoplift. Sick of hearing everyone complain when they thoughtless. Taste the pain, it's like candy canes. It makes me go change into a better frame, into a better name. Society's insane, we all live for fame, yeah.
You know how this works by now, over emotional video to end the night, and I'll do this bit and then the montage will be humongous. I'm aware that I've taken a lot of videos, so probably a video montage, and then I'll do a big picture one at the end. What a night from WrestleZone, top start to finish. Every match hit, every match was amazing. Adam will have a great review, I'm sure. K&K Wrestle Factory will have a great review. Got loads of pictures of folk. I dressed up as Mickey Vago. The leather jacket is now in the bin because it was flaky. It was just absolutely ruined. So it's now in the bin. But I had an absolute blast as always. Aspen didn't win, which, you know, emotionally fraught as always. But it was such a fun night, and I just love coming to WrestleZone shows. So the next one's December 3rd. I'm due to go to W3L on December 2nd. So I'm gonna have to do some major dadding. I'm gonna do some major nights to get two nights of the wrestling. But it's gonna be amazing. It's gonna be a great night. It has been a great night. Ronan King absolutely knocked out of the park against Grado. You forget how amazing, or how much of a superstar Grado is until you see him wrestle again after 3 years, and he's just, he's got such a superstar aura. He's amazing. He's fantastic. I'm going to use amazing a lot in this little bit because I'm just absolutely wrecked and ruined by 3 hours of wrestling. It's been just an incredible night, and as always, thank you, WrestleZone. I'll probably do some thoughts and that on the website swnscotland.com. I'll probably do that on Monday or something. But yeah, it's been another emotional show, as always. But special shout out just to everyone. You all had an incredible night. You all had an excellent match. You all made us feel emotions. You all made us just react and enjoy the show, which is what you should be doing. But yeah, it's so many good moments, so many great things happening, so many great characters, so many great, just matches and moments. So like I say, I'll do a bit more of an actual review in writing when I've got all the thoughts formulated in my brain. But in the meantime, I don't know if I've got a bit after this. I'll probably have the photo montage. I might put out a question on Twitter, so you might see me back in the SWN Towers, back in the studio, and doing a little bit, answering some questions. But if this is the last bit before the photo montage, I hope you enjoy these little kind of vlogs, these vlogs of the days, because they are minisodes, they're not interviews. They're just me having a grand old time going to the wrestling. And once again, I bought a Monster Pineapple, like Ultra Gold. That was a waste of time again. I think that might be a bad luck charm. But it's been great. I'm going to go find some food now. It's my natural instinct to go find some food. Not Domino's this time. Not fancying pizza. But I have to go to Tesco. So I'll go to Tesco and do it. So yeah. Thank you for watching. Thank you for continuing to support SWN. I really appreciate it. And I hope you all have a good day, night, evening, afternoon, whenever you watch this. See ya. Hello, we're back in the studio in SWN Towers, as just, that's where I am. I was going to say as always, but yeah, I seem to be always be in this room. So that was WrestleZone Halloween Hijinks. There was a lot of videos. There's a massive montage. I think it's about 6 minutes long. So I apologize for the audio listeners that have dealt with that. That there's just a lot of montaging, but there's a lot of videos taken. I realized when I was looking back through Brian Battensby's photos, that I spent a lot of time taking photos, and that's just a bit of a crap thing on my end, because I want to enjoy the show, but I was very conscious that I would do a montage as well, so I took far more than I probably needed to, but I still enjoyed the show, so you know, it all works. So we've got loads of questions through Twitter, so I'm going to go and answer them now. I'm really excited to go through this, and I've got the post credit, so there's going to be this bit. The bit at the end where it's like the credits, and there's going to be the montage of the photos, which is about a minute and a half long, and then there's the little post credit, a little thingy that we do on these episodes. So keep an eye out for it. I really enjoyed it. I don't know if anyone else will find it funny. Hopefully one or two of you there are WrestleZone fans will find it funny. That's the most important thing for this particular kind of episode. If it's about Halloween hijinks, it's about a WrestleZone show. The next kind of episode that we'll be doing like this is going to be a double. At the moment, that's the plan anyway. It's going to be a double Christmas episode. We're going to be doing W3L Wrestling Showdown when it comes to Elgin on December 2nd. And then we'll also be doing, there'll be like two half episode. The next part will be WrestleZone Christmas Chaos. That is the plan. We'll be doing that because that's on December 3rd. So it'll be two nights of wrestling that I'll be going to. And which is funny because I watched back a little bit. I did in my car after the show, and obviously I'm gonna have to do some major dadding to earn two nights of the wrestling, and leaving Jack with Kelly for two nights on the bounce. And as soon as I went home and went right, Aspen lost, and they're gonna have a rematch in the steel cage on December 3rd. And she turned to me and went, "Well, that's okay. I can use my mum's car that day. You just go." And I was like, yes, I am taking this with two hands. Yes, we're doing two nights of the wrestling. So we're doing W3L on the 2nd and then WrestleZone on the 3rd. And I think that's probably me for the year. And then that'll probably be it until Summer Hill in January. So yeah, the show itself, I'm going back through memories. And it was just so much fun. Like I said, when I was going through the photos, memories, and there was just so many good things. Like everything just clicked. There wasn't like a moment where you're like going, "Oh, this is a bit rubbish actually," or I wasn't that excited about the match, or I didn't finish the match satisfied. I was always satisfied at the end of it. So it was just an incredible night for WrestleZone, who have just nailed every show I've been to for them this year. Whether it's ones in Aberdeen, whether it's Ellen, whether it's Inverurie, they've just absolutely just made incredible memories, incredible moments on those shows. So questions on Twitter, let's get them answered, because I don't want to do another 20-minute rant, because I've already done that at the start of this episode. Right, so we've got Callum. who took a picture of me and Vago together. It's a bit more zoomed out because they're one I took myself. So that's somewhere in this episode, I think. Someone once went home with half a table. Why didn't someone go home with half a door? I have the answer for that. One, the table that was the raffle prize for Christmas Chaos was from Aberdeen Anarchy, so it wasn't actually given away the same night. There you go. And I don't think there's much left of the door, or either door, after the main event, after Aspen versus Zach. So there's your two reasons for that. It hasn't been given away as a prize yet. What is it in Iron Brew that makes burritos so great? I don't know. I mean, that's weirdly timed because I do have a bottle of sugar-free Iron Brew, so of course it's piss water, but you know it'll do. Don't know. Grado is just you've like I said in in the previous bit. I forgot or you forget how much of a superstar Grado is until you actually see him wrestling again. You're like, oh my God, this guy's a superstar. This guy is literally this is he has literally transcended Scottish wrestling. So to see him wrestle in a little venue like Carl Aberdeen in that room, it was just like, wow, we're going to see greater wrestling again. It was just amazing. Will, right, I'm going to just read this as verbatim. Will Mickey Vaguely and Blue Tundra ever tag together? They have. They have tagged together. So I think it was on gala shows, maybe. I'm sure if you go back through the mosh pit, there it's no, it wasn't. It was Ellen. Wrestled Ellen. I'm sure it was. Right, hang on. Go double check. Just I'm sure it was Ellen because I remember. I'm gonna be so wrong here, but I'm sure it was Ellen. This is great for everyone that's again listening. Ellen. There we go. The Foundation of the Future defeated Heavy Metal Thunder, which is Mickey Vago and Blue Thunder by pinfall. So they have teamed together. There we go. And last but certainly not least, is Brian Tucker still a Wally? It seems so. It seems like he still is a bit of a Wally. So we've got a loser leaves. Well, we're not entirely sure what the rules are here because Brian, in his fluster at the end of his match with Scotty Swift after the backslide party, said that it was a loser leaves town match on December 2nd. But the WrestleZone management or whoever does their social media has put up a loser leaves WrestleZone challenge. So I'm waiting for confirmation to find out what's happening. But I love the idea of doing a loser leaves town match, not in Aberdeen, like doing a loser leaves town in Montrose or Inverurie. So that means every year when they do shows in Inverurie or Montrose, Brian Tucker would go up and go, right, where's my match? And Len will turn to him and go, no, you're not allowed to wrestle in that town. You're not allowed to wrestle there. Or even if they do loser leaves town and they do it in Aberdeen for, at Deanston. And then each year, every time that there's a show in Inverurie or Montrose, for example, these are my two examples, apparently. And that's when Brian Tucker can actually get booked on matches. So he has like three matches a year because it's the only times you can actually get matches. And I don't know, you can maybe throw it down the homeless route and just have him getting tattier each time and until he can win back his right to wrestle on shows again. This is why I don't book shows. It's very obvious why when I say things like that. Right, so we've got Kyle Watt, of course, Cactus Kyle, as he was at the show in his old Foley garb. Who had the best outfit on the show? And his correct answer is Ronan King. Yeah, Ronan, pretty much. He had like the White Power Ranger kind of vibe going with his tights. It was probably some sort of other thing that I don't know about because I'm old. But I was thinking as soon as I saw the tights with the gold stripes and everything, I was like, White Power Ranger. That's Tommy. That's Tommy, the White Power Ranger, right there and then. Yeah, that's pretty much. I'm trying to think. I mean, Vagos is pretty cool. With his, I mean, not as cool as how I was dressed as Vago, but yeah, Vagos is pretty cool. And Omar is always a good shout for just a proper cool look. I did enjoy Restock is bringing back the Tartan Trues, not for his match, but for his accompanying Brian Tucker. Brian Tucker has a bunnet, which Omar also stole. Omar Muhammad in a bunnet. Excellent. That's always wonderful. Let's see, because there were some suggestions thrown in as well.
which was for Omar. Yep, retro Omar Muhammad. But with his decent shoes, so it's all good. I'll never forget. And yeah, of course, Ronan as well was gone about. Daniel did throw out, this is, so not on the show itself, but when we're seeing the fans coming in with their costumes, we see there's a big picture on the WrestleZone Facebook page, which has like there's a Danhausen, Kayla came as Trish Stratus, Kyle came as McFoley Cactus Jack, I came as Mickey Vago. There was some incredible costumes. I came as a zombie Connor Malloy. There was a Mr. P. There was an Al Snow, which Grado took a picture of the kid afterwards and messaged Al Snow with that picture. So I'm intrigued to see, listen to Wrestling Daft if it actually comes about and Al Snow replies. There were some really great ones, but the best one was the one Daniel suggested on Twitter, which was Damien's daughter, who came in a poo emoji. It had pictures of the foundation of the future on it. So Zach Dynamite, Bruiser Brad Evans, Ryan Riley, and it had like things pointing at Smelly, and it was like foundation of the Poocher. Oh, perfect. Just, that's a class costume. That's amazing. So we had that. That was ace. I like Connor's. Connor's had a cool costume on the show as well. It was full skeleton garb, which he wrestled in. But no, it's pretty hard to top Ronan King. So I'm sorry to everyone else. Although Scott had his Geely, and as we've established, I'm old, so I love a nice Geely. I'm actually after a Geely, so any recommendations where to get one? I've actually got a sleeveless hoodie on the way, which I'm very excited by. That's it now, 32, and I'm excited by a sleeveless hoodie. Right, okay, so what else we've got? Ronan King. Of course, it wouldn't be a podcast, it wouldn't be one of these shows without Ronan King jumping in with some questions. How accurate is the statement, the best 18-year-old wrestler in the world, Ronan King, which is how he wants himself to be announced as? I don't name me any more 18-year-old wrestlers right now that can do what Ronan can do. There's a lot of good, really good wrestlers that are right about that age, just about there, or like just around about 18. But Ronan King is a very incredible talent, and it annoys me so much that I'm giving him all this compliments, because he's going to turn it around and never let me forget that I say any of these things. But he is an absolute incredible wrestler. The fact that he was able to do things like doing the front flip over the top rope and landing on his feet, that's now the second time I've seen him do it. The first time I saw him do it, he landed it. He actually landed on, I think it might be either Conor Malloy or it was Zach Dynamite. It was that triple threat, Trinity Center. But this time he missed it, but still landed on his feet. And the fact that he went in with Grado and looked like $1 million. Grado, of course, is a very given wrestler anyway. He's very much a heel. He'll just make you look good just because he's Grado. But the fact that Ronan, I don't think he's had a bad match that I've seen so far. He's got a really good character. He's got a really good larger-than-life confidence and ability. He's really there's so many guys in WrestleZone that I'm just pegging as guys that will be big deals. More recently, I was like, Bruiser Brad was just one that stood out for me, because look at him, he's just massive and he's really good in the ring, really charismatic. He's just like, get him on shows. But Ronan as well is in that category. He's just so good and incredibly good for his age, which actually it's scary and it's disgusting how good he is. And his boy's 14 years younger than me, and he's doing things I couldn't imagine doing at 18. So yeah, he's just, I don't know, a brilliant wrestler. I think maybe you just need to calm down a little bit, but you know, he's doing well, so who am I to judge? Speaking of that, right, so at Aberdeen Anarchy, I can't remember if I said it on any podcast I did, but Ronan, speaking of Ronan, had a good moment where he hit Vago with a guitar and threw it behind him. And he threw it behind him, he hit a young girl by mistake. I can't remember her name off the top of my head. I think maybe Amy or something like that. But during this show, during the pre-show, the triple threat between Chris Archer, Omar Muhammad, and Rhys Dawkins, Dawkins had a green skull with him. And he threw it out, and it came that close to hitting her again. And I don't know if she's just cursed to be in front row at these shows, but it was like, oh my God, we can't have this twice in a calendar year with the same person. So yeah, that was just a wee funny highlight. But no, it was a fantastic night. I can't wait to go back in December for Christmas Chaos. I'm hoping, praying that the steel cage match is the one that Aspen wins, because I mean, I don't know at this point, they keep reeling me in. WrestleZone have just reeled me in to the point where I can't not go now. In general, I am missing the Academy shows. That's just a bit too short notice, and I've got that many things on in November, which I think is November 12th. Yeah, I've got a couple things on. Kelly's at 6. I'm going to see you at 6, so I'll be home with the boy. But yeah, there's these shows, they're so hard to miss now because so much happens and so many incredible matches happen on these shows also. So I'm trying to get to as many as I can. I've done pretty good this year, considering all the wild things that's happened in real life as well. So hopefully next year I'll be back for Summer Hill. But I'm definitely going to get to putting that out there into Christmas Chaos. So that's the bunch of questions that we got through the Twitterverse. I've answered them all there. We've got a bunch of stuff coming up on the SW1 podcast. By the time this comes out, I would have hopefully spoken to Fulton King. Loads of questions coming in for Fulton King, so I don't really need to do main notes at all, but I will still do so. And that's it. So like I said, I don't want to take too much time for this bit because I've taken up loads of time at the start and I've got the big montage in the middle. But again, thank you to WrestleZone and the guys at WrestleZone for providing an amazing couple hours of entertainment for me and for everyone else. And I apologize for how much you had to hoover that hall because of my jacket, my flaky leather jacket, which went into the bin as soon as I got a picture with Vago for myself. So it wasn't evidence that I was trying to dispose of. I didn't even check the pockets. That might not have been a good idea. Oh, if anyone has that jacket. Anyway, right, so I'm going to go. So thank you for continuing to support SWN, swnscotland.com. Follow us on Twitter at Scott Resnett. Follow us on Facebook, Scott Resnett. Instagram's the same as well. I am really bad at replying to anything, but if you get into my DMs on Twitter, they are open. Hopefully I'll be able to help out, or if you want to be on the show, we'll try and get it arranged as soon as we possibly can. But my voice is still croaking. It's Tuesday, so I'm going to go and rest it. I'm going to have some of this sugar-free iron brew and go for a sleep. So have a good one. Thank you for watching.
Where's Wally?